What's up, YouTube? How are you doing? Chana D, your techno dad here, and in this video, we're going to be going over what you need to look for when you're buying a TV this holiday season, or for Black Friday, or what have you. And if you want to keep that TV for a long time and not have to make the mistake of buying one and be like, oops, well, this one isn't working for what I need it to do, and so now it's time to get a new one. You don't want to do that. You don't want to feel that way. It's happened to me before. It sucks. Anyway, we're going to get into it right after a quick word from our show sponsor, Vizio. If you're looking to upgrade your TV this holiday season, you should check out the options from Vizio. From the budget-ranged M series to the P Quantum series and the massive 85-inch P Quantum X, Vizio has you covered. With the new IQ Active and Ultra processors, combined with Quantum Dot Color and the most powerful local dimming backlight in the industry, the 2020 lineup of Vizio TVs should be on your short list. Now, me personally, I'm excited for the Vizio OLED as it's the only OLED in the country that supports HDR10+ and Dolby Vision. Vizio's new Pro Gaming Engine delivers a more responsive gaming experience with industry-leading input lag, AMD FreeSync and FreeSync Premium, and support for 4K 120Hz gaming. Check out the 2020 lineup of Vizio TVs at the link below. And I'm back. So if you have, you know, wanted to buy a TV and don't know exactly what you're looking for, you know, you want like 4K, you know, you want some sort of HDR, maybe you want some gaming features, you have come to the right place, because we're going to go over everything that I kind of, you know, over the last 4 years, you know, this is the fourth time I'm making a video like this. And, you know, after being a judge at the 4K TV shootout, I really kind of want to make sure you guys know what is important, because it's not always about picture quality. I know it's not always about picture quality. So let's start off with the first thing you should think about, and that is budget. Oh, and if you're new to the channel, don't forget to hit that subscribe button and that bell so you get notified when the next video is released. I got a lot more TV review videos and TV setup videos coming at you, so make sure you stay tuned. All right, so when you're shopping, you should definitely have a budget in mind, and you should kind of keep to that for sure, but maybe increase it 100 to 200, maybe just give yourself a little bit of room, because there could be a good deal. Now, with the whole COVID-19 thing, everybody is buying stuff online, and the cool part is we have companies like Best Buy doing, you know, Black Friday deals all month long. So that's kind of cool. And who knows, you might actually find, you know, an extra $100, $150, $200 off on Black Friday. So just keep that in mind, as you might find a better TV for just a little bit more money. And that's kind of like what I'm saying to you here. So I know a lot of people want to get like an 85 or a 75 at a certain brand, and, you know, they're expecting to pay, you know, let's say $1,800 or whatever. If you notice, you could probably get a 65 inch of the better TV at the same price as well. So make sure you shop around in your price range. Don't just be stuck on, I got to have a 75, I got to have an 85. Because again, if you go down in size, you can go up a TV level. So keep that in mind as well, because that you can find some good deals during the holiday season. Now, as far as defining what levels, you know, the TVs are, I got a lot of flack for saying anything under $1,000 is budget level. So, you know, I can take that down to 800. So maybe 800 and below is in the budget category. 800 to maybe 1700 is the mid range, and 1700 plus is going to be premium, because there's actually quite a few TVs that cost over $2,000. And, you know, if that's up your alley, cool. If it's not, hey, there are plenty of options. So don't be worried that you're not spending so much money as other people. Just do what's right for you and for your budget. From what I've realized doing this for the past 4 years is that if you want to buy a TV from LG, Sony, or Samsung, I think the real, what you want to get over is that $1,000 hump. Once you pass a $1,000 range, you start to get better quality, like exponentially better than their options in the $500 to $600 range. So keep that in mind. Now, if your budget only tops out at $800 or $900, definitely check out TCL, Hisense, and Vizio, as they pack a lot of features into their TVs these days. And since, you know, LG, Samsung, and Sony aren't really doing too much to innovate, It could be a great opportunity for you guys to grab a good TV with a ton of features at a lower price point if you stray away from Sony, LG, and Samsung. All right, so the second consideration is viewing environment. Where is the TV going? Is it going to be going into a living room like mine that has seven ginormous windows? Is it going into a bedroom that's pretty much dark and majority of the time you're watching TV at night? Is it going into a man cave, a garage, a third, fourth, fifth bedroom? I don't know. It all depends, you know. Do you have a large space, meaning do you need something with good viewing angles, or is it a kind of a confined space where you're straight onto the TV and there isn't that much seating, like off to the sides of the TV? That also could impact your purchase as well. In a super bright room, you might want to go with an LED LCD TV because it's got higher brightness than an OLED. However, if you have a room where, you know, you need all kinds of, you know, viewing angles, maybe you want to go with an OLED because the viewing angles are great. You don't get that color shift that happens with a lot of LEDs. So these are things you definitely want to think about. Like in my house, we have west-facing windows. So in the summertime, in the afternoon, like pretty much from 3 to like 7 p.m. until the sun goes down, we got light coming in, shining in behind the TV. So these are kinds of things that you want to think about as far as longevity of the TV. You know, do you do a lot of watching during the daytime? You know, before in the past previous years, I would be like, oh yeah, you're probably at work, so it's not that big of a deal. But now if you are at home, then maybe you are watching a lot of TV during the daytime. So that could be a consideration you want to think about. Next is viewing habits. What are you watching or playing on the TV? Is it sports? Is it everything 1080i coming in from, you know, a whatever cable or DirecTV? Or are you just streaming? Are you a cord cutter, video game player? Are you just a movie fan and you've got a whole library of physical media and that's what you're watching on the TV? These kinds of things you also want to think about, because if you're pretty much watching 1080i from whatever cable box, then you need to make sure that the internal upscaling of the TV looks good, right? And if you watch a lot of sports, you want to make sure the motion handling of the TV is good. These are things that you want to look out for. Do you play the same video game for 12 to 18 hours straight a day? If that's the case, yeah, you probably might want to skip on the OLED and go with an LED. Do you watch a lot of news? Like a lot. Again, like we're talking extensive amounts of time watching the news, like 12 to 18 hours. Maybe skip the OLED. Maybe. But if you're constantly changing up what you're doing, like if you're watching regular from a cable box for a couple hours and then you switch over to streaming and then you go play a couple of video games and then you come back to watching TV on the cable box, you know, if you're constantly changing what you're watching, then maybe an OLED is good. I haven't had any problems with mine, but we do watch all kinds of different stuff on the TV. And the TV's on for quite some time, like about 10 hours a day. So make sure you take that into account when you are purchasing or looking for a TV. Next, we have features. What features does a TV need to have for you to be happy? And that's only something that you can actually figure out. Like, that it can't be for anybody else. It's got to be for you. You're the one putting up the money. So make sure it has the features you want. Picture quality isn't everything. I could have gone with the Sony A9G from 2019, but I decided to go with the LG OLED instead. And that was due to its feature set. I wanted to have HDMI 2.1 ports, and in 2019, LG was the only TV manufacturer putting 2.1 HDMI ports into their TVs. One of the things you do want to watch out for in the features area is the TV manufacturer adding features via firmware. Now, this is a little tricky thing because we know that sometimes they promise things and they just do not follow through. Samsung 2019 TVs, they've been waiting for an eARC update pretty much all year, and it hasn't happened yet, and we don't know what's going to happen there. Sony X900H is supposed to get all the good gaming features, supposed to, and, you know, it was supposed to be a PlayStation 5-ready TV, and the PlayStation 5 releases, and the TV is still not PlayStation 5 ready. So definitely be careful with TV manufacturers promising a feature, because they might just be like, yeah, yeah, we'll promise it. And then now 2021 rolls around and they got a new TV with the feature in it. And then the 2020 TVs just kind of are hung out to dry. So be careful about that. I hate it when they do that. I miss the days when the TV was here and you got it and everything worked. Like, they're just trying to, you know, meet their deadlines and put out a product that isn't ready for prime time, promising a firmware update to add these features. And it's, I don't like it. I don't like that at all. So make sure, you know, and if you do have one of these TVs and you're waiting it out and it's not happening, I feel for you. I'm sorry. These kinds of things happen. So make sure that if you're buying a TV, it has all the features already there, so you don't have to wait for an update, because you are putting up the money now for a promise of a feature later. To me, that's kind of dicey. I do like the fact that firmware updates can fix bugs in the TV. Yes, that is cool. But full-on feature promises and rollouts will definitely take some time. Now, in this feature category, I think HDR is a huge deal. So let's talk about that. Now, if you don't know what HDR is, it's high dynamic range. And there are quite a few formats of HDR these days. There's actually five. There's HLG, HDR10, HDR10 Plus, Dolby Vision, and Technicolor. Now, Technicolor only exists on the LGs. I'm not sure if it's OLED only or if it applies to their LEDs, but it's not something that's, you know, noticed and active. You can activate Technicolor HDR on pretty much anything. So in my mind, yeah, it kind of doesn't count. In my mind, there's four main HDR formats. There's HLG, which stands for hybrid log gamma. And that's something from broadcast, right? Now, there hasn't been a lot of broadcasts in HLG, but HDR on YouTube apps is coming in through HLG via VP9. And if you pop on like the HDR channel on YouTube app on your TV, usually you'll see that little HDR flag pop up in the upper right-hand corner. So that is what HLG is. It's broadcast and for YouTube purposes. HDR10 is the base HDR, which kind of came out a few years ago before Dolby Vision. And that's what a lot of movies are based on. So HDR10 has what's called static metadata, meaning all the HDR metadata is locked in at the beginning of the piece of content. Now, when we get to Dolby Vision or HDR10 Plus, that's when we get to dynamic metadata, meaning the metadata that tells HDR to act in a certain way is changing scene by scene. So throughout the movie or piece of content you're watching, the HDR will kind of, I guess, fluctuate is the easiest way to say, like, it'll change. Okay, all that metadata will change. Now, why is there an HDR10 Plus and a Dolby Vision? Well, that's kind of a funny story. Dolby Vision has been adopted by LG and Sony and a bunch of other TV manufacturers. But when this was all happening, Samsung didn't want to either pay Dolby for the licensing or they wanted to do something better. So Samsung got together with Panasonic and they came up with an open source dynamic metadata format called HDR10 Plus, which is supposed to rival Dolby Vision and do the same thing. Change the HDR metadata as the scenes change in the piece of content you're watching. Now, I know a lot of people are like, well, these other things like Dolby Vision don't really matter because it's 12-bit and we don't have any 12-bit panels. And I totally get that. But I feel like a lot of the Dolby Vision content is better than the standard HDR10 content. Now, if you're like, well, what if, you know, I'm looking at a TV that doesn't have HDR10 Plus or Dolby Vision, don't worry. If a piece of content is in Dolby Vision, it is a layer on top of HDR10, and so is HDR10 Plus. So whatever content you throw at your TV, even if your TV only has HDR10 compatibility, it will, you know, take that base layer of HDR10 and stay at that static metadata. It won't access the dynamic metadata, but you're still good. You're still getting that HDR. Now, one of the funny things about this whole HDR10 Plus and Dolby Vision thing is that basically, if you were a Samsung fan, you can't get Dolby Vision because Samsung TVs don't support Dolby Vision. And if you're an LG fan, you don't get HDR10 Plus. And along comes companies like Vizio and Hisense be like, hey, we offer both. And I'm the type of person is like, why can't my TV just have all the formats of HDR? Because we don't know where the content is coming from. Like, I have some IMAX enhanced discs that are HDR10 plus, and I have a bunch of discs that are Dolby Vision. I have a bunch of discs that are standard HDR10. And it makes sense to me to have a TV that supports all of those things, because maybe my wife wants to watch something on Amazon Prime Video that's in HDR10 plus. I want to see it in HDR10 plus. So it's a kind of weird situation, as you know, some of the big manufacturers of TVs just don't support all the HDR formats. And I think this is where, like, the other guys like Vizio and Hisense can really come in and take some of that market share, because they're one of the only TV brands that are, you know, supporting all these formats of HDR. And that Vizio OLED is the only OLED in the country that supports both HDR10 Plus and Dolby Vision, which I think is a pretty huge deal. Now, if you have something like an Apple TV or something that supports Dolby Vision, then make sure your TV has Dolby Vision, or the new TV you're going to get does have Dolby Vision. So just kind of watch out for whatever devices you're currently using, if they are compatible with everything your new TV is going to have as well. Now, I briefly touched on HDMI 2.1 in the features section, because I do feel that is a feature. So let's talk about that in general. Again, I wanted HDMI 2.1 ports on my LG OLED, and that's why I picked that up instead of the Sony OLED. And it's because I knew I was going to be getting in the Xbox Series X and the PlayStation 5, and I would be running tests and just making sure I knew everything worked on the consoles with the TV, so I went with the LG. So what does HDMI 2.1 actually bring to the table? And that's higher bandwidth, higher resolution, higher frame rates. Now, a lot of people want to lump in auto low latency mode, ALLM, variable refresh rate, VRR, enhanced audio return channel, EARC. Most people want to lump those into HDMI 2.1, but it's a common misconception. Those features have been in HDMI 2.0B, and those HDMI 2.0B ports have actually been in devices since around 2018. So if you had a TV or an AVR since 2018, chances are there's probably a firmware update that has allowed those features or unlocked those features to be active on those devices. Denon did it. I know a bunch of other AV manufacturers, Sony even did it with an older STRDN1080. They added EARC to that. So these are older devices that were already using the HDMI 2.0B chipset that were just unlocked with a firmware update. So the real thing that HDMI 2.1 brings to the table is 4K 120, 8K 60, 10K 30, I believe, and of course 48 gigabits bandwidth. Now, a lot of these HDMI 2.1 ports right now are capped at 40 gigabits per second, which some people think is okay, some people don't think it's okay. So it all depends on you and what it is you want. Chances are, if you're in the vast majority of people, you probably won't need 48 gigabits per second. And then there are the purists that are like, well, it's not HDMI 2.1 unless it is 48 gigabits per second. And you can go back and forth for hours and days on that. We're not going to do that here. Just so you know, that is a situation. Okay, I'm just letting you know of the situation. You do with that information what you will. And again, going back to the whole features via firmware update, I would highly recommend that you get a TV that, if you want it for, you know, 4K 120 gaming, that everything is already there. Wait for the bugs to be, you know, figured out. And I made a video 4 months ago telling people, if you're buying a TV for a gaming console, just hold off until HDMI 2.1 is fleshed out. We are in the very, very early stages of it. We've got compatibility with console A, no compatibility with AV receiver B. You know, there's just so much stuff. The best thing to do is wait. Unless, of course, you have tons of money and you're just ready to throw money at the situation. Cool. Totally cool. I love buying stuff. So, you know, I'll probably buy something and be like, ah, crap, it doesn't work. Now what? Well, I'm stuck with it until it's fixed. So if you're okay with that, then cool. But if you would rather spend your money more wisely than me, then definitely waiting is the best option. Now, moving on to something that a lot of people don't think about, and that is operating system. Now, all these TVs have different operating system. There's Tizen on the Samsung, LG has WebOS, Sony has Android TV. There's the TCL has Roku, and I think SmartCast on a bunch of the Vizio and Hisense stuff. So test driving those operating systems are probably one of the biggest things you're going to want to do. And I know it's kind of tough to get out to a store right now to test those out. I think one of the big things you need to think about is if you stream a lot of content from certain apps, Hulu, Netflix, Vudu, Peacock, Disney Plus, you're probably going to want to make sure that you're getting all of the features on those apps for that specific operating system. Meaning, if you watch a lot of Disney Plus right now and you're getting Dolby Atmos and Dolby Vision and all that kind of cool stuff, and then you buy a new TV and then you download the Disney Plus app and it doesn't have all that stuff, are you going to be disappointed? Is that something that's going to bother you? Make sure you know what you're buying when you're buying it. And the TV OS is definitely, it varies from TV to TV and app to app. So it's one of those things where you just kind of have to do some research and figure out which TV operating system you're going to use. Now, of course, if you have a streaming box, then obviously that is not an issue. But if you are one of the people that use the TV's built-in apps, definitely know what you're buying before you buy it. All right, one last thing to mention, and I've seen this trend happening every CES I've gone to, the TV feet get wider and wider apart. So if you are putting this in a place where, like my bedroom, it's gonna sit on top of a dresser, yes, I'm sure I can mount it to the wall, but the amount of TVs I have to put in the bedroom to review, mounting it on the wall and then taking it down and mounting it, that's something I can't do by myself. Therefore, I'm always going to prefer some sort of pedestal stand. I ended up, if you've seen my Sony A8H video or even the TCL R635 video that I made, I actually have a tabletop from IKEA that I put on top of the dresser, which allows me to put these 55-inch TVs in the room. Otherwise, I would have to, you know, mount them to the wall. And that's just a whole endeavor that I don't want to have to do because the amount of TVs I'm swapping in and out is just insane. And it's a trend that's been happening. The feet get wider and wider and wider. So you're almost at the edge of the TV. So if you have a small whatever TV stand, make sure those feet fit on there. Otherwise, you're going to have to find out a different solution. Now, you can always mount a TV to a wall. Just make sure whatever mount you get is fully articulating. That's a little bit easier. And of course, it has the same VESA mount pattern, either 200 by 200, 300 by 200, 300 by 300, 400 by 400. So just make sure whatever TV mount you buy matches up with what kind of VESA mount your TV has. And if you are actually putting your TV above a fireplace, make sure you look into mantle mount. That is probably one of the coolest things I've ever seen. I saw it at Cedia the last 3 years. They even have a motorized one. It's great. It brings the TV down to your eye level so you don't get that strain in the back of your neck. Definitely something to look into. All right, so final thoughts. I know there are a lot of options in this TV situation, and you can get a TV for $100 and you can get a TV for $30,000. And chances are, whatever TV you get still might not be perfect. And that's just something that you kind of have to live with. That's something you just kind of have to get used to. There's going to be quirks on every TV, some things you love, some things you don't love at all. And it's really just based on, you know, what it is you want to deal with and, of course, how much money you want to spend. So I hope this guide has been good for you in the fact that you can learn something about what you need to think about when you're buying a TV, especially in this holiday season when there's deals flashing by and deals coming to your inbox all the time. Just make sure you step back, take a deep breath, and before you make that decision, just kind of go over in your head, well, what is it that I really want? What is it that I really need? And what TVs can deliver those things? That's the big overarching idea here in this video, is do what's right for you. Now, if you're still wondering which TV is the best for you and your use case and your budget, and you want to ask me, go ahead and leave those in the comments below or hit me up on social or email, whichever you like to use. Well, that's pretty much it for this video. If you liked it, go ahead, smash that like button, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel using the button in the middle of your screen. Once again, my name is Chana D. I'm your techno dad, and I'll see you next time.